Welcome to the Awakened Goddess Show, your source for inspiration, wisdom, and personal discovery. The place to learn from a diverse mix of mentors, metaphysical experts, spiritual leaders, and best-selling authors from around the world. I'm Angela Wilkinson, mindset mentor and founder of the Awakened Goddess Academy. Join me as I explore the minds of my masterful guests while they share powerful insights and easy-to-use tools you can start using right away. Now, let's tap into the energy of the Awakened Goddess and be enlightened by today's guest. Well, welcome, Dianne, to the Awakened Goddess Show. You know, I've been really looking forward to talking with you because, you know, I was looking into some of your YouTube videos and some of your other past interviews, and oh gosh, you know, this is one of my favorite topics to talk about, quantum, you know, with the quantum field and the matrix and all of the unlimited possibilities. So welcome.
Thank you so much, Angela. I'm so glad to hear that. I've been listening to some of your shows, all interesting. And I was listening, I tuned into the one on quantum hologram or, yeah, right. Well, yeah. This is the age. This is the quantum age. So here we are. We need to learn as much as we can to be able to live in it properly, right? Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. And I feel like every conversation takes us just one step further. It's like farther along on that edge. So how perfect is this?
You know, it really is. And when you said that, what came to me, Angela, is that we think we're having conscious conversations, right? Which we are on all these shows, and you've done lots of shows, and I've been on literally hundreds of shows. And it just occurred to me, it came through that there's something bigger going on as we're in these conversations.
Yes.
And of course, not just you and me, mm-hmm. in this particular case, but the whole field, the whole quantum field of connection with everyone listening, whether, you know, whenever, beyond the limits of space-time.
Yes.
So there's something that we're actually imprinting, like generating, activating, as we're in these conversations.
Mm-hmm. And I love that you say that, because what I've gotten over the last, I'd say, month or so about the Awakened Goddess Show is that there is a life force of its own. It's like the show has become this entity that is larger than me. And I am finding, and I've always kind of thought this, that I am the channel, the vessel for whatever information is supposed to come through and be presented. So I always say I attempt to get out of the way and allow whatever's supposed to come through to, you know, I allow that to happen. So
yeah, and you know, it's a both and, just to quantum think it, right? It's a both and, because you are that unique vessel through which the totality of the wisdom and the creativity and the inspiration and the passion is coming through. And at the same time, you as the persona, as the, you know, the worldly identity self called Angela, and all the roles we play, I like to always think of it as the both end, that we're that unbounded, infinite self, and at the same time, an individualized, right, in the form who we are playing in this beautiful, all the beautiful roles we play in an earthly, mundane sense. So the transcendent and the immanent at the same time. And, you know, a friend of mine who you may have known, and she made her transition a few years ago, Debbie Ford, did you ever know her? Right, who her thing was the shadow process.
Yeah.
And she was originally in Miami, so she was a good friend of my husband, Alan, and myself. Alan Collins is master quantum thing coach, my partner in all things for over 25 years, I like to mention. And Debbie, once, when I was first writing Do You Quantum Think, the book, and she was giving me a little bit of coaching as an author, and she said, this is what, so I'm translating that through. Thank you, Debbie. Because I said, well, you know, I'm just the vehicle. I'm just, you know, whatever comes through. And she said, no, no, no. She said, listen, you have to do the work. You're doing the work. Mm-hmm. So don't invalidate that aspect of ourselves. Of course, we're having the conversation and we're saying it for everyone, mm-hmm. because I really do think that we're in this time where we are in this, quote, great shift, in this great transformation for humanity, for all of life, and who knows how far out into the cosmos. But, and so I think that what's really being pointed to is that, as you found it in this current expression of the Awakened Goddess Show, that each of us are now feeling that pulse of, well, how do we best express our purpose, our gifts, our talents, that which can only come uniquely through each one of us now. And I think that has everything to do with getting very centered, focused, clearing the energy field of our being so that we can make those clear channel connections. Not that we're all a channel of wisdom, but I don't mean a channel like another entity coming through. Mm-hmm. Maybe some people have that going on, but I'm talking about just being able to connect to that wisdom that our soul blueprint is here now to receive, to translate, to give to the rest of the world.
Mm-hmm. And I think that what you just said is so important, because boy, oh boy, have I had to really grow and step into, even most recently, step into fear. Because recently I took the show to the video format, and that was, you know, talk about, you know, quantum leap. For me, I was comfortable doing the interviews just as the audio version, but then it was just like it just like friggin' ramped it up with the video, and
it's it really does.
and this, it's like this compulsion, this forward movement, the momentum is just like, and I feel like I don't even in a sense have a choice. It's like this is my calling. It is pulling from me this piece, because it's like, you know, I just opened this can. I don't want to say can of worms because it's much more beautiful than
it's
that.
Not,
but, right.
Portal.
This portal. Yeah. And it's just like, hold on to your hat, because it's like a wild ride. Yeah.
And it is. And it is so different. And I totally get what you're talking about, because you were saying about fear. And it's like, so I know when I get invited, and I think this is the beauty of using these metaphysical, esoteric, all these different modalities, is that you look and see, how do I step, you know, how do I step into it? It's not an absolute. Quantum thinking is no absolutes, right? Everything is energy in flux, informed by intelligence. And it's consciousness, it's multidimensional, it's all of the above simultaneously. But we know there's no static and fixed reality. But when we're focused in the physical, which the old world view, I lovingly call the industrial age view, scientific materialism, has conditioned us to that, then everything looks fixed, circumstances look fixed. But anyway, getting back to the facing the fear in the projector, is that when I get invited to something and I think, I don't want to do that.
Exactly.
You know? And I know I have to do that. Okay.
Right.
And it usually, you know, and that's what it is. And so it's that, okay, fear. You know, I really like to, when you're in the, well, conscious self-mastery, okay, which is what my work is all about, is that, okay, I'm feeling fear. How do I deal with it? And you know, it's beyond everything is fear or love. Okay, that's nice in one sense. I'm not saying anything about it. But when it's our present moment experience that we're dealing with, right? So you're experiencing the fear. And I like to then look at it and think, well, what am I really afraid of? You know, without getting into a big analysis, it's just having being able to create new relationship with it in the moment that it occurs, so that you're saying, yeah, I'm afraid, but I'm doing it anyway, because as you said, it's like we're in this collaboration, right, with infinite intelligence, and we're all here doing it together, creating this new way of being for human beings. We're creating this, what we want to have a better life on Earth. We want to be able to transcend that whole paradigm of the good and evil, and you know, all the old world views. There'll always be people dying of hunger. There'll always be people, right? There'll always be war. That's human nature. Well, in an infinite possibility universe, why do we have to live in that story? Why must we live in that reality? We don't have to. But this is where you bring yourself to the next level and go beyond the limits of whatever beliefs, collectively or otherwise, or individually, or it can be familial. I call them least action pathways, the way the energy or the thought goes, simply because it's been that route before. We don't have to be stuck with any of it. So the fear, right, that you feel, you obviously went beyond it, but it is a whole another thing. And I love, we were talking before the show, I like TV, I like video, but I've been on so many shows that are on radio and podcasts, and it's so easy, right? Job, pajamas, no makeup, right? You're a natural goddess. And it's so much simpler. And then all of a sudden, it's hair and makeup and lighting and sound and what's the background, and you know, it's not pink flamingo showing back there on the shelf, which somebody told me on a video the other day. But you know, and it becomes a bigger thing, and it becomes a bigger presence. And I think that the what you're saying, Angela, about follow it, you know, like just go with it and see what if this came to us. And of course, there's discernment. It doesn't mean we say yes to everything that comes along. But if we know, like as you and I know, in different situations that I've been invited to, that I don't want to do this, but I have to, you know, I'm going to do it. That, okay, let me step in. Let me step in and step up. And I think that it really works. I just have to say real quick, because an example is that I knew this lovely guy. His name was Michael, and he put on production events, and he did this thing called Inspired in New York Awards, Inspired in, and he was doing Inspired in Miami, and he loved quantum thinking, loved my book, and he said, I want you to be, I'm doing an awards show this weekend. I want you to be the host. Do the interviews of the honorees. I said, well, I'm usually being interviewed. I thought, I like being the host too, but I said, why don't you get, you know, someone from, you know, one of the TV stations? He goes, no, I have to have a quantum thinker. I said, well, let me think about it. I'll come down to your hotel tomorrow and we'll discuss it. Meanwhile, it was going to be 2 days from that moment. But I hadn't committed. And so the next day, my husband Alan tells me, oh, I just received a press release for this Inspired in Miami Awards, and it's got you as the host. But I didn't, so I went to see Michael. I said, Michael, was there something did I say yes to something that I don't realize? So then it was, I was interviewing one of the stars of Shark Tank. Do you know that show?
Love that show.
And Damon John, to be exact. And he's a lovely, wonderful guy, very humble guy who became very successful and just, you know, really a gentleman. And two other choreographers who were famous choreographers for Step Up Revolution and different movies and the Olympics and different. But I didn't know anything about them. So now I was one day away. I went, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? So it was one of those where, okay, obviously I wasn't going to say no.
Right.
And I just stepped into it. And something came to me while I was doing it, because I started, you know, getting my nails done, looking on, you know, watching all the YouTube videos of their shows and their movies and everything. What am I going to ask? I can't remember everything. And I didn't want to use notes. Like, you're not using notes, right? So we want to be spontaneous. So I did devise a way, and it just came through me that, and I said, one of the great choreographers in our time today, would you like to tell them about all the accomplishments? You probably never got a chance to actually say it. So somehow the intelligence comes through us when we have the intent to connect. And I wanted to just share that story to make it real for people, because we're talking the abstract a little bit. And that you can just step in, because I think, and you talk to a lot of people, I think a lot of people are a little bit, you know, have a little bit of trepidation about stepping into the next expression of who we each are right now. Are you finding that too?
Yeah, and as you were talking, it came to mind that one of the pieces that I have finally figured out, right, is that the less I think about it and I just step in and follow that inner feeling, that knowing or whatever, that resonance inside, then I don't get in my own way. So it's like, even like recently I was stepping into an experience that was extremely, I'd say, scary for me, up-leveling experience. And I kept getting the sense, I felt like I was walking down a really dark tunnel with the tiniest little flashlight. And I couldn't see the end, but I was just stepping forward and just trusting and knowing that I was going in the right direction, even though I didn't really understand like the how to like get things done or do what I thought I needed to do to get to the end. And so that was just a really, really transformative experience for me to actually step through.
Yeah. And you know, when you said the tiniest little flashlight, and you know, I think I even wrote, and is that the tiniest flame, right, in a darkened room can illuminate the whole room. So that little tiny, right? But it's very interesting how we manage, how we follow our intent. And in quantum think, I make a distinction between intent and intention. Intent being the activation of the field, the energy, intelligent, conscious field. So you could say your personal resonance, and intention being the specific and measurable result. So you could say that if you wanted to live your purpose, you know, and you saw yourself as, I'm going to be the star of my own TV show. Okay, so that would be an intention. It's a future end result. But a statement of intent might be something like, You know, I'm thrilled that people are relating to me as a television personality. Mm-hmm. And I'm really excited about how it's unfolding. So that's not an end result. And, you know, there are many different ways that we could express a statement of intent. It's a context that you're choosing to live from. And it relates to what you wanted to say that, because it relates to what you were saying. Well, first of all, I wanted to say it because I think people get, that's where we have to make the distinction of, you know, what's the difference between quantum thinking and ordinary thinking? Well, it's many, because it's a whole new framework that puts all of this together, all these spiritual and scientific principles made practical, integrated, becoming the walking, talking, living wisdom of it. But the other thing about it is that when we think of creating an intention, well, the industrial age worldview that we've all been brought up in, 400 years, we're not 400 years old, but it's been conditioning the background of our culture, the assumptions of our culture, only physical is real. Even though we know they're spiritual, energetic, and divine. But at the same time, what happens is that we think of things as cause and effect. Mm-hmm. I create my intention, and then it's, you know, that's mechanical. Push on this, that moves. But intent is a more shamanic sense of things, which I'm sure you are familiar with. But it's good to be able to make these distinctions, because mm-hmm. in that sense, it has to do with a field effect, not a cause and effect. Mm-hmm. So when you work in the realm of intent, which I call one of the five natural faculties of mind, intent, intuition, subtle energy, resonance, and meditation, that I consider a faculty, not just a practice, that what happens is you will generate, activate connections to many results, not just one, not mm-hmm. just have an intention, cause and effect. But let's say I'm an entertainer, I'm a television personality, mm-hmm. and then who knows what's going to come up. And that is where you said you had that little light, right? And you're walking and you're just following. Mm-hmm. Because when you think of what I like to use, the analogy or metaphor of the science, where they say they can only see 4% of the visible material universe. The other 96% is dark energy or dark matter. So it's there, but they don't know what it is, or, you know, what's the nature of it. So when you think, you create your intent and your intention, you know, both, that you, and it's not even always so literal, I think, Angela. I think it's more, you know, what we hold in the feeling tone of our being.
Right.
That we have some very, let's say, substantive, fundamental intent of who we are and who we're here to be and how we're here to express ourselves. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So it's, sometimes it doesn't even have to be said. But when you're holding that and you know that you're here with a particular purpose that gets distinguished, that you can distinguish over time, there's a distinction in the quantum thing is actually a system of 21 principles and practices for the mind and awareness that has us take this literal quantum leap in consciousness, so that we're living and thinking and feeling from the expanded, more accurate, up-to-date worldview, mm-hmm. rather than looking at it from an undifferentiated place or your current place trying to get there. You're that you put yourself there with intent, by intent, and you start to look and live from it. When you have this, I like to think of it as 90 and 10% because it's easier. So let's say 10% that you can see right now, mm-hmm. even what you can envision, in your imagination. But 90% of that connectivity to infinite intelligence, to the non-local mind field, that you don't know. I like to call it living in the unknowable. Mm-hmm. It's like not living like, what is going to happen? But it's living, it's like knowing that there are operating principles that maybe we can't even, we don't know how to describe. We're not sure exactly how they work. Science is getting closer to it now. But we know that they work. Mm-hmm. So you have your intent and allowing, and that's that light you're mm-hmm. following, because you're tuning in to yourself and knowing this is the path right now that you're following. And then you allow for what connects, what comes your way. It mm-hmm. is all about connections, like the internet. What right. becomes your reality, the infinite mind of humanity, the good, the bad, the ugly, and the sublime, whatever you click on. Mm-hmm. Connection, it's what you connect into. So your intent and intuition are ways of connecting in. And so what I was asking you is that when you had that little light, then what happened? Did you start to have things come to you that maybe you didn't expect? That was my question.
Yeah, it was like I just knew to keep moving forward. And I kept thinking to myself, I have no idea of the how this is possible, what it is I'm supposed to do. I just, every step of the way, felt like things were revealed to me. It's like, okay, so this is the next step. This is the next step. And so, yeah, it was just a very embodied experience is all I can describe it. It was, I was so out of my head, because my head could not rationalize, because usually I'm like, I got this covered, I can figure this out, I need to do X, Y, Z, and it was very different from that, very different.
Right, and that is, when I talk, I make the distinction, the quantum worldview, the industrial, and how that influences our patterns of thinking, mm-hmm. not just our thinking. But, quantum think is designed to take you, it's not just about the cognitive, what we would say mentation, mm-hmm. but to an expanded state of being. So it's that how-to, right? The industrial age gave us the how-to culture, which is still, it's not like we're trading in one for another. It's not an either or. It's an expansion that right. we're in of how we relate to reality, how we live from that more expanded worldview, which we know now the science is, as I used to say when I first heard about it, it took them thousands of years, but they're finally figuring it out. No, that, right? All mm-hmm. the perennial ancient wisdom, the eternal wisdom, all the mastery traditions knew, the universe is holistic and holographic, it's a field, it's multidimensional, all those things.
It's pretty funny. It's pretty funny that it's like it's been there all along and we're finally tapping into it. It's like, wait a second, it's almost like this surreal experience.
I know, but it's really fun because when you look at it and you think, I have this view, let's call it a view, that we project, I mean, we as human beings project our level of evolution into the world to further evolve. So in other words, we know there are distinctions, but no actual separation, right? As above, so below, as mm-hmm. within, so without. So we're looking at it and we say all these things, right? In the consciousness community, your outer world is a reflection of your inner state. And it is, but when we look at it from this larger view of humanity and you think, what happened in the industrial age? It was the beginning of classical science where we needed to organize. We were bringing society to a place of organizing, categorizing, you know, getting things in place. It gave us the distinctions of the various sciences and so many different things of genius. Mm-hmm. But then we forgot. I think we forgot, and we got lost in the only physical is real idea. And so when you look in, you know, I give a lot this example, educational, in conventional education, what did we study? We didn't study the faculties of mind, intent, we're mm-hmm. studying what? The physical. So all of our institutions that we're living in the developed world have been born under the industrial age way of thinking. Mm-hmm. And so we needed to have those how-to steps. It's still relevant in many areas of learning. But now we've reached this place where we have projected the next, right, or however you want to call it, fifth dimensional reality. You know, so many different ways of saying it, as you know. But going to this leap in consciousness to take ourselves on this evolutionary leap, which at this point is an evolution in consciousness, and I think the physical is also restructuring. But in astrology, it is a period of restructuring that we're in right now, a 16-year period of restructuring that started in 2008. And it's a restructuring of the institutions, because if you look at, so it looks like chaos. Mm-hmm. And it's getting people nervous. That's why I like to bring this topic up, right? Yeah. Because it looks like, oh my God, the world's falling apart.
Yeah.
But in fact, when you're looking from this larger perspective, then you can see, oh, the level of evolution that we reached in the industrial age that gave rise to machines, and I say, not to insult, in many ways we became mechanical, you know, in the way we think, in mm-hmm. our belief systems and things, that they become automatic. We're not in that awakened goddess state, you know, awakened in the state beyond the automatic, whatever conclusions we've made, which is fine, but if it's not effective, if we have beliefs or conclusions that we're living in collectively and individually that are not giving us the experience we want in life for mm-hmm. ourselves and others, then we can say, well, wait a minute, I'm not stuck with that thought, that belief, that system, any of it. But getting back to the bigger picture, so what we're seeing now is we're seeing that there is a restructuring going on in the educational, the health, pick any system, society of societal system that we're living in, the economic system, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. All of it, where new thinking is essential now. Because as Einstein said, and I call it the modern day mantra, everybody repeats it, the level of thinking that gave us our current problems is insufficient to resolving it, to solving. Yeah. So we have to go to this next level. And there's one other thing I want to say about it. So when we see this breakdown, it's not to be fearful or worried about it. It's to say, great, because they have reached their level of effectiveness, mm-hmm. or at least that aspect of that institution. And we know education, the way it's taught, it's all changing. Many thousands, millions of people are working to bring about. So we're all working on this together. But I think for each of us to stay focused in knowing that there is a new wanting to emerge. And the paradox is the new worldview is emerging around us. And we, at the same time, paradoxically, we're the ones bringing it about. So mm-hmm. for me, it's not just about awareness. It's about, and the masters say, becoming established in that state. becoming established in the state of a master. My view is we're here for that. Mm-hmm. That's what the masters have said throughout the generations. And so to think of ourselves as anything less is maybe not helpful. Let's put it mildly.
Right. Well, it certainly isn't limitless.
That's true. Here's another paradoxical statement. Your mind is your life, and you are not your mind. We'll get to the major. Your mind is your life because whatever we are aware of, when I use mind, I mean what we hold in our awareness in this moment. Mm-hmm. Whatever we're aware of in this moment is giving us our experience of life, you know. And the thoughts we have, the meanings we give our thoughts, give rise to our experience, give rise to our emotional state, and more, right? And so it's like a gestalt. It's not like a sequential linear thing. It's like, it's just there. And your mind is your life from that point of view. And it's everything, you know, inspiration, feelings of awe, just sense of the sacred, matters of the heart, you know, your heart connection, your thoughts, all of it. And you are not your mind because you are that unbounded, infinite, free awareness that is in yoga called the watcher of mind, right? Mm-hmm. That aspect of us where we know we are connected as, oh, I'm getting a feeling now of it, of all that is, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So your mind is your life and you are not your mind. So when you look at, you know, when I was growing up, I wanted to know, well, how do we really create what we want in life? And so along, you know, in order to create anything, you have to know what are the dynamics of creation. Mm-hmm. Well, you come across as you think, so you become, right? The Buddha said all that we are is a result of what we have thought. They say it in the Upanishads, in the Judaic and Christian Bibles. It's said in, you know, all the, in the 30s and 40s, all the, you know, Think and Grow Rich, Napoleon Hill, they all said the same thing, tapping into that wisdom. That I thought, if all you had to do is change your thought to change the world, to change my life, why does it still look the way it does? Right? There's something wrong. It's like thought creates reality. Well, how does it do that? You know? So that's when I made a discovery. And I met Dr. Fred Allen Wolf. You know him because I know you know the movie,
yeah.
What the Bleep Do We Know? And we were working on a project together years ago. It was a TV project. It never turned into a TV show, but it was great to work with him. And we were talking, and he showed me how scientists make a discovery. You know, like what we were saying before about, well, the ancient wisdom was there. It was there all along now, the scientists. But it's great that the scientists are now showing more how it works,
right.
Giving insight into it. So mm-hmm. it's not an alternative reality. It's not new age, woo-woo, la-la land. It's like, get with it. You know, this is the updated knowledge that if you're brought up in a worldview that doesn't acknowledge mind as the creative force, right? As consciousness, as the fundamental substratum of reality, then how can you become adept at creating anything?
It's, right.
I mean, we do. I always look at humanity and say, it's a miracle we create what we do, given some, right? But it's somehow it's working. There's this self-organizing principle, as you and I say, bigger than both of us, Angela. So it's like, I wanted to know. And Fred taught me that scientists make a discovery and then they invent language to label it. And then that language comes into our, well, it comes into the total language. and starts to come into our thinking and starts to shape our lives. So I use in Do You Quantum Think the example Quantum Leap, because everyone knows that term.
Right.
So Quantum Leap, one of the fathers of quantum physics, Max Planck, said, energy does not move in a smooth, continuous flow. It bursts in leaps, in packets of energy that he called quanta, hence the term quantum. Quantum leap, right? And that a quantum leap is anything discontinuous with the former state of affairs, right? Mm-hmm. An instantaneous shift.
Yeah.
Or an instantaneous leap, you know, inside the orbit, outside the orbit of the atom, whatever. So I'm not a scientist. So I just look at, quantum think is about how the discoveries of science have already shaped the way we think and given us certain limitations in the old world model and how we can now expand ourselves. So I started thinking about this with my conversation with Fred. And then I realized that it was not one term. It was the whole system, because I knew that science had made this huge paradigm shift, this leap from the classical physics, which had to do with, right, physical matter, looking into what is physical matter, breaking it down, particle, whatever, and to quantum physics. In current culture, we're in a quantum age. Mm-hmm. Still under the influence, even to the best and the brightest and the boldest of us on a conscious path, still a lot under the influence of how the industrial age has shaped our thinking, linear, step by step. Circumstances, I say it like this, as I say, for young minds, for kids, I go, old worldview, circumstance rules. New worldview, intent rules. Mm-hmm. You have to trick your mind in a way beyond the circumstances, beyond the evidence. The old worldview is evidence-based, true or false. You're guilty or you're not. But we know that's a limited, it's a view of reality, it's valid. It's a limited view. Mm-hmm. And it will keep us limited if we stay in that. So that's the next level, right, of like getting free of the matrix where you think that's all that is. Mm-hmm. That all there is what happens to be coming across your thoughtosphere right now, you know? No. And then going to the next level is being able to distinguish, oh, I don't have to be stuck with any thought that I have. Wretched self syndrome, I call it. The I'm not good enough in any variation on that theme. Mm-hmm. Good enough, I don't think I can, but never happened in my family, we've never had this. You know, what if I can't, the world is coming apart. And any variation on that theme, those are not thoughts that are going to generate the resonant field that you want. And so you're not stuck with it. So that's where you start to say, quantum thinking, you're in it, you're embraced by the system, so you don't have to measure and monitor every single thought. It becomes a way of life, the observer effect. Quantum worldview is not the end all and all be all either, because we're on, you know, the nature that we can see, it evolves, it always goes to its next higher place.
Yeah.
So it's a remembrance. And, you know, it just brought to mind something I quoted in Do You Quantum Think from the late, great quantum physicist David Bohm, B-O-H-M. And he said, you have to have enough faith, probably paraphrasing, but not too much. You have to have enough faith in your worldview to go along with it, but not so much faith that you... Now I'm paraphrasing, get stuck in it, get lost in it. Mm-hmm. And so
it's like having a foot in two different worlds or two different perceptions.
That's exactly right. Because, you know, the kind of thinking that the industrial age gave us, analysis, ordinary logic, we need that. We need to be able, you know, obviously for survival. It's coming from knowing. We're always coming from knowing. There's a practice in quantum thing called listen from not knowing. And you have to do that as a conscious act, because automatically we listen from knowing. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, because we've had experiences, we do have knowledge we've accumulated, and we have to survive. So what is listening from not knowing? It's a very interesting, powerful practice. And I do it with my husband, because Alan and I have been working and living together for 26 years. We've been married. And so you think, okay, right? We make, well, the least action pathway mm-hmm. of relationship mm-hmm. is, oh, I know what he's going to say. Yeah. I know he's like this, yeah. right? She's like that. I wish you weren't so much like that, right?
Yeah.
So when we're sitting, we have what I call our morning debate over breakfast. We read spiritual literature together. We have a great time. And then we have this same intent in life, but we see a different perspective, which makes it electric and fun. Mm-hmm. So we're always debating something, you know, like we're debating Black Lives Matter or Donald Trump, you know, whatever. We have different views. And so when I listen to him, I do that practice. I have to catch myself in the least action pathway. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hurry up and finish what you're going to say. So I my two cents in, right? That's real. And I have to say, okay, let me listen from not knowing. Mm-hmm. And it's an instantaneous, it's a quantum leap effect mm-hmm. because it's an instantaneous shift in consciousness, in awareness, where I have to put aside, I don't have to, but I choose to, I put aside all, whatever I know about him, and be with him as if we're here together for the first time in this moment. Fact is, that's truth, right? Because every moment is new. Mm-hmm. So the fact is, I've never been here in this moment with him. And what happens is, when you listen that way, the field, because we're always in a field. Now remember, the old worldview conditioned us to, you know, the physical. So we weren't thinking about invisible fields mm-hmm. of connectivity, right? Of right. awareness, of love, of any of that, relational fields. And that's how the observer effect works, because it's through the field. Now, even though we've all experienced it, because you walk into a room of happy people, you feel it. Mm-hmm. You didn't even hear what they said, right? You feel it.
Right.
You know it, either your inner knowing, your intuition, or however else, you're tuning into the subtle energy of it, all the different ways that we're, you know, multi-intelligence going on all the time. So but we haven't been accustomed to relating to the field mm-hmm. as a way of life. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
So when you start to listen from not knowing as a conscious act in the moment, what happens is, first of all, the other person, the person you're listening to, is not experiencing intrusion. Mm. See, because mm-hmm. when we're with each other, this is subtle, and you understand yeah. subtle energy. It's that you feel the intrusion, or you feel like the other person, hurry up, you mm-hmm, know, get it out. I got to get my scent. Right? You can feel it. So what happens when you listen from not knowing, you're releasing that energetically. So the other person can be in the serendipitous moment mm-hmm. where what you and I have been talking about, you keep mentioning, and I'm glad, where you're allowing what's coming through us. It becomes a creative dialogue, and the field that is an intelligent mind field that we are surrounded and always in. Things, and they say in quantum land, bubble up you know, what bubbles up from the quantum foam, it's like that.
Mm-hmm.
It begins to bubble up solutions, ideas that you couldn't have thought of if you didn't clear, if you didn't make, you know, get rid of the static on the radio of your being and the other person's.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so powerful in relationship to just do that one little practice.
Yeah. It's like holding space for the universe.
It is. Yeah. That's exactly right. That's exactly a beautiful, eloquent way of saying it. You're allowing the universe to, you know, we're collaborating,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
Holding that space. It's nice.
So I really feel like I want, I know this is a topic that we could spend a tremendous amount of time on, and, you know, we just have just a few moments left. I'm wondering if you can say just a few words about mastering resonance.
Okay.
In a nutshell.
Why not? Something that I use, like a sort of an exercise,
yes,
that I use.
Oh, okay, that's perfect, because I always like to finish with a practical tip. So let's give a practical
okay,
tip.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
That would be perfect. See, it's all divinely, you know, inspired.
It really is. You're amazing. I just love being with you. Anyway.
Thank you. Likewise.
I can see why your show is so popular. Everybody wants to be with you, Angela. That's good. That's a
You're
good
thing.
You're
making me blush.
Anyway, what I do is when, you know, I say, think of it this way. Think of yourself like a 1,000-stringed instrument, right? And so let's say you have an intent, right? And remember, intent is the activation, so you're getting many results.
Mm-hmm.
But let's say, or you can call it an intention, it's both, where you want an end result. But what's happening, usually it's a field effect, because it's a state of being that's going to give rise to many, to the what you want in an aspect of your life. So let's say 950 of your strings of your instrument are all in tune with that intent.
Mm-hmm.
But you have 50 that are out of tune. They're not in the harmonic, right?
Yeah.
So what I call that, so I say, very simple, draw a circle, and I do this with my clients, private consulting clients, old worldview circle, new worldview circle. Now, in this case, it's your personal old worldview, which is really your current worldview. And I say, okay, in the old worldview circle, the current worldview, let's say you have, like, we need something to focus on.
Let's do money. Because I think money is, you know, everybody can.
Money is big.
That's an easy one.
I like the topic of money, although it took me to the end of the book. I put it in the last thing, living fully dimensionally. It's all about money. But anyway, money. So you have many what we would call unaware intent. Because intent, the way we use it in quantum think,
mm-hmm.
is something that you are generating with the awareness that you're generating it consciously. But intent is like the feeling tone of your being, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's resonance.
Mm-hmm.
So what we also are resonating, what we call unaware intent. It's still intent.
Yes.
Intent is always functioning. So what happens is, you know, the proverbial foot on the brake and the accelerator at the same time, because you have this great intent, but then you have all these other conversations. So we say, make a circle, old world view of money, my old world, and you put down in that circle everything that comes out of your mouth around that topic. This is how you know what it is, because you're saying it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Why can't I get money? Why is it so hard? Why is
right.
it never enough? Yeah, that kind of stuff.
Exactly. Or, you know, it's not my karma, dharma, whatever. And so that is part of the, and then you have the good things, right? Mm-hmm. That you say, wow, I've always been good with money. I know how to manage it and all the good things. So you have the good, the bad, the ugly, and the sublime in there. And then you take that and you look at it and you say, there will be a theme that you can find mm-hmm. through that network of intents. And it might be something like, I want to generate $1 million a year revenue in my business, but I know I never will.
Yeah.
Because that's what will come out of it.
Yeah.
It's like, I can, I won't, I never have, my parents didn't, you know, whatever. I did and I lost it, whatever you say. And so that's the thematic intent that you're walking around with. Like, mm-hmm. I want it, but I'm not going to get it.
Yeah, because there's always that heavy but.
That's it. So then you look at that now from a quantum worldview. There's no absolutes other than what you think of a source creator. I'm not talking about that. For everyday human being, everyday life, there's no fixed reality. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to believe your own thoughts. Just because you have a thought doesn't make it the truth. You don't have to believe it. Most of the thoughts we have are not even ours. They're just intel picking up from the field. And importantly, you don't have to identify with it in any way. Mm, so you yeah. look at it and you realize, okay, that whole thing, that's not the truth. And then you have your new worldview circle. And this is very, very important. I'm glad you brought this up. And the new worldview circle, you don't have to fill it all in. But you do, in the new worldview circle, you create your new statement of intent that you're choosing to live from. Mm-hmm. Now, intent, you know, that it's like saying, I love that, you know, I love that I'm becoming a multimillionaire. It's not based in evidence. Mm-hmm. This is very important when you're difference between quantum thinking and positive thinking. Positive thinking would be having a positive affirmation. I will make $1 million. I will make $1 million. Write it on your, you know. On top of that negative belief or negative assumption that in some way you're holding in your being as the truth, okay? It's always good to have positive thoughts, but that's the difference. Positive mm-hmm. thinking is a positive thing covering up a negative, as Alan right. says. It's like peanut butter on top of jelly. I mean, jelly on top of peanut butter. Take a bite and pretend the peanut butter is not there, but it's there. Mm-hmm. But you're not stuck with it. Quantum thinking is that you know that if there are no absolute fixed way that something is, that you are, that he is, the government is, the world is, my money situation is, then what's creating reality? Context. A statement of intent is a state of context that you are choosing to live from. Is the glass half empty or half full?
Right.
Same level, the circumstance is the same. It's what I'm choosing to live from. And it's not a Pollyanna statement. It's because you understand the dynamic of creation, the active dynamic that we've been divinely bestowed with by human birth, is the power of intent to place our directed attention and energy that is generating a resonance. Mm-hmm. And that I can live from that. So if I say, I'm delighted. I always use this because it's easier for people with money. I'm delighted the way my financial status is unfolding. I'm delighted with it.
Yeah.
Because what's the difference? I'm not happy about it or I'm happy about it. Mm-hmm. Neither one of those statements is the absolute truth. That's the good news in creating, how we want the resonance. This is how we master our resonant field, mm-hmm. is you shape it consciously But it's essential knowledge, the two fundamental essentials. There's no fixed way that reality is. It's energy in flux in every moment, an infinite number of ways that we can hold what we hold in mind. And so I just say it like this, no absolute realities, and that we exist in fields. Mm-hmm. And so what we're generating the field that we decide to live in. And we know that, you know, people, if they have a practice of meditation, if you're tuned into mastery energy work or whatever it is like that, you're raising your vibration. But you also have to attend to the thoughts in your mind.
Right.
And the words that come out of your mouth. And that, I think, for people who have been on a conscious path, for anybody, if you're on a conscious path, you don't know it, or if you're on a conscious path and you know it, is that this next level is to actually pay attention to how these mind dynamics work, mm-hmm. and to catch ourselves and just go, oh, there's my least action pathway. Don't give it any meaning. There's no analysis. For me, it's like there is only this moment. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's the truth of it. So, in this moment, can I shape my resonance that's reverberating out? Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Do I have to? This is what I, you know, infinite possibility. If you want to live with the subconscious mind, more power to you, be my guest. But when I think about it, Angela, I think, do I want, if I have to depend on a big analysis of my subconscious mind and I better get in touch with it, otherwise I'm never going to be happy or have all the money I want. That to me sounds like too much work. And again, it's not the truth. Mm-hmm. There's no absolute way. We can distinguish any number of realities. We all on this planet live in so many different realities, right? The wrestlers, I mean, I look at some, right? You look at all the different realities people live in, their mm-hmm. belief systems and right. all kinds of stuff. We're not stuck with that. So when we want to be able to create consciously, I just find it that, for me, not appealing and not effective mm-hmm. and not necessary. Because if you live in this moment and you realize that you have a choice in the context that you will live from and how you will hold reality, even when the circumstances don't yet match up, the actual mm-hmm. manifestation. But what's going to have it match up is how you choose to hold it now.
Right.
And it's simple. You just have to remember those two things. No absolutes. I'm not stuck with it. I'm not saying that, oh, I have, you know, millions of dollars when I don't mm-hmm. physically in the bank. But I can say I'm happy about becoming a multimillionaire. Mm-hmm. You can say that, and right? You could say that.
Yeah. Well, because it feels like it's in motion. And I think that makes it feel different, resonate different.
Exactly. And, you know, we've worked with many, you know, we have worked in our business mostly in corporations we did it by design to work with executives and senior leaders in corporations because we feel, you know, they're quantum thinking, they're leaders, then they're, you know, it's emanating out. Mm-hmm. And these are not people necessarily that, as I say, were they on a conscious path? Everybody's evolving. Were they thinking about it? Maybe not.
Right.
But they could hear it through these worldviews and being able to see how our thinking has been shaped and how we can go to, you know, see the limits of our current thinking and go beyond it. And so it's been very acceptable. But the important thing is it's been very effective. And then we did public programs, and we're going to be doing that again. So please sign up on my mailing list so we can inform you. But we're going to be doing other things. And the point being that Quantum Think is not just a book that I wrote that all of a sudden, you know, here, Quantum Think. It's something that we've been presenting in the world. Everyone says I did it backwards. So, you know, did the work in the workshops, and I created the system, and it's a trademark system, the Quantum Think system. And then I put the books to make it more available. But the idea is that I've seen, so we've had many, many clients and people in our programs over more than 20 years. I've seen people shift in an instant. A 20-year relationship that wasn't working of coworkers, a relationship with estranged family members where the family member would shift them. And why? It's not because of me. It's because they got these principles integrated that you shift your state. And this is the importance of resonance and to be aware of what you're resonating. Mm-hmm. When you shift your state, we exist in relational fields, even when the person is not there physically with you. Mm-hmm. You shift the relationship.
Right.
Instantaneously, when you shift how you resonate with that person, how you resonate with the relationship. And we always say it, it's not like you're not trying to manipulate the other person. You say, you know, we love each other, we respect each other, you know, and you decide you're going to live from that. And that's really, it seems like, you know, that's why people call it woo-woo, but it's actually the dynamic of creation, and that's how it works. And in science, it's called sympathetic resonance. That what resonates in the same frequency, that's a scientific term. I'm not, again, not a scientist. I know a few things about it. That what is in the same frequency will attract. And there's an article I read about, they're trying to use sound to build objects in space. They're experimenting with that now.
Cool.
And, right. And there's a thing called cymatics. I don't know if you ever saw it, where they spin this spinning disc, and it spins into an exact geometric pattern.
Yes.
And, you know, when you start to look at all that and you realize, well, how do we master our resonance? Well, how do we create in life? How do we relate to life? Through what we say, through the thoughts that we allow ourselves to have. Again, one last thing on the thought, that to free everyone from your thoughts that you don't want.
Yeah.
And again, I told my husband, you can't change your thoughts. They get there before you do. Right? Think about that. Reflect, contemplate that. So what do you do with them? You make a distinction between a thought that you initiate, that you know you're initiating, and a thought that we say just visits. Let it fly by like a bird past your window. We live here in Miami Beach. So we're always seeing the pelicans fly by. They're all going north right now at the time of this recording. But seriously, that what happens is, and Alan used to say, you don't hop on the back of every bird that flies by. Don't hop on the back of every thought that flies by.
That's good.
And I say, you don't, you know, most of the thoughts we have, we did not originate. We did not initiate. I call it the myth of choice. Because if you were choosing, here's the proof, living proof, you would not choose to have a disparaging thought, a denigrating thought about yourself or someone you love if you were choosing. So what's choosing? Least action pathways, cultural least action pathways, familial least action pathways, Least action pathways, a term I use, so that we give it no meaning, no analysis. Mm-hmm. It's just, there's a, it's a way that you create a healthy relationship with your thoughts, what I just said. Mm-hmm. Distinguish between what you're choosing. And sometimes, you know, the thoughts come in and it's like, right? It takes
you off. Yeah, where'd that come from?
You're like, you know, flotsam and jetsam on the sea of life, and your thought is, I'll be in the shower, right? We all talk about that.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll go into like a thought field and say, wait a minute, I don't want that thought. And then consciously shift to something else. So how do we, it's all these things. How do we master our resonance? Mm-hmm. It's being in an awakened state, established in the state. Mm-hmm. That's quantum thinking.
Woo! Wow. My mind has just been expanded, that's for certain. This conversation was more than I ever imagined. No pun intended. And right? Oh my gosh. Well, thank you so much for joining me. This was incredible.
Wonderful. You're such a wonderful holding the space of a great conversation. I really, really appreciate being able to share and share with you and
co-create and play and expand. And this was incredible.
It's been great. Thank you so much, Angela.
Thank you. Great work. And now for you, my gorgeous goddess. Was there something from the show that resonated with you? If so, I'd love to hear about it. Head on over to today's show page at theawakenedgoddess.com and leave me a comment. Did you enjoy this episode? If so, subscribe to the show on iTunes and please share it with all of your friends. And if you want even more incredible resources, join the Awakened Goddess community to get bonus content from the show. And until next time, goodbye, everyone. Thank you for listening to this episode of the Awakened Goddess Show. I hope you enjoyed today's guest and got something you can start using in your life right away. For more spiritual insights and to listen to more episodes, subscribe to The Awakened Goddess Show at theawakenedgoddess.com and discover wisdom that'll change your life.